Do you want to play two-player split-screen local deathmatch Duke Nukem 3D on your iPhone? Well, now you can. I'm not sure why you'd want to, but you can. Hey again, everyone. There's been a pretty big development in emulation due to Apple's shift in App Store policies. This isn't the news I was hoping to bring today. No, sadly, iDOS 2, the DOSBox port for iOS, still hasn't been allowed back on the Apple App Store. However, something you're probably all familiar with, RetroArch has just launched on the App Store. Today I'll go over the setup a little on what features are here and what's missing from the iOS build, and test out a few games on a handful of system cores. Head over to the App Store, type RetroArch into the search bar, and tap Get. That's all it's going to take to get more than 70 emulators for classic consoles on your iPhone or iPad. Once RetroArch is downloaded, open the app and you'll see a slightly janky looking interface, but probably only for a brief moment. RetroArch will automatically download and extract the assets pack with the icons, themes, fonts, and basic configuration files. One of the first things you're probably going to want to do is tap on the online updater and refresh the core info files, controller profiles, databases, and shaders if you intend on using them. Downloading the cheats can take a long time and takes up quite a bit of space, so if you don't use cheats, skip the download. There's also the issue of unzipping hundreds of thousands of very tiny files onto the iOS file system. I'm not sure if I exactly trust the garbage collection to be able to handle that without any errors cropping up. Certain RetroArch cores require extra system files, and they can be downloaded through the Core System Files downloader. Other cores require external BIOS files, which can be a little tricky with RetroArch on iOS, but I'll show you how to add those later. I'm not really going to go into too much detail about adding ROMs. You can download them directly to your device and use the Files app to put them in a subfolder of the RetroArch folder, or add them through application file sharing in iTunes from your computer. I suggest using a PC or Mac in iTunes, but that's up to you. Try to keep the ROMs for each system in separate folders. Mixing them limits how you can scan and add games in RetroArch. Once the files are added, tap Import Content. I'll show how a manual scan works. Tap the content directory and this will put the browser in the RetroArch app's home directory. This directory isn't accessible in the app file sharing in iTunes. You can add things here, but you can't delete them from app file sharing in iTunes. So I like to put my ROMs one directory up. So hit parent directory and then select directory and then hit scan this directory. Select the system name from the drop-down list. If you name your game folders according to this naming scheme, you'll be able to auto-scan your ROMs and have the proper game names appear in the playlists. Select a default core to launch a particular emulator with this system's games. And if the files are zipped, select Scan Inside Archives. For Final Burn Neo Arcade ROMs, you'll probably need an arcade info DAT file to get proper names. Put the DAT files in your ROMs directory and select the DAT file to find it using the file browser. If you need to overwrite a previous playlist with misnamed files, turn on the toggle switch. The setting for auto-downloading thumbnails is enabled by default, so with any luck, you'll have playlists with nice crisp thumbnails to browse through. The three-window icon at the top will switch between views in the default theme, and if you tap the thumbnail, you can bring up a zoom. You may also want to pair a Bluetooth gamepad. I'm using a third-party DualShock 4 clone that works pretty well. The DualShock 4 pad is auto-mapped to have the PlayStation button bring up the quick menu, and one of the face buttons acts as the coin and the other as starter select in arcade emulators like Final Burn Neo. And one nice feature that I wasn't really expecting it to have is rumble support. 3D Ultra Thrill Ride Pinball for the Game Boy Color triggered the DualShock 4 rumble function when the ball was launched and when the bumpers are hit hard. It's unexpected and really fun. The last bit of configuration I want to touch on before looking at gameplay is the extra BIOS files. You can probably find a RetroArch system files pack somewhere. Somewhere. If you look hard enough. If you want to use one of those packs, extract it to a directory and then put that directory alongside your ROMs on your Apple device. In the configuration options and the directory settings menu, select the location where you've put the system files. You can use the Files app on your device to move any system files downloaded by the RetroArch installer from the old system directory to the new one. That's a few basic tweaks to the RetroArch front-end settings to make the user experience a little more cozy. RetroArch is highly configurable and it's easy to get lost in the options. So just a reminder that each level has its own settings that can override levels below. Game-specific configurations can override core configurations, and core configurations can override system-level defaults. I'm not going to be going into system, core, and game configurations here. Now that RetroArch for iOS is released into the wild, it's going to take some time to figure out what the ideal core and game settings may be to squeeze out extra performance. So, just how well did things perform? Overall, not too bad. It's very impressive in some areas, and a little bit of a letdown in some others. All but the most demanding or specifically difficult to emulate games seem to be at least playable. And this seems to be a feature-complete build of RetroArch, so it has all the modern improvements including rewind, save states, netplay, and fun addition to retro gaming, retro achievements. Those are enabled if you set up your account in the configuration. Just how playable games are varies quite a bit between game and core. It's not just as simple as saying things work until some arbitrary generation. Consoles like the NES, Game Boy, Color and Advance, the Genesis and Mega Drive, TurboGrafx and PC Engine, and all the Final Burn Neo games that I've tried can be emulated very well. And I'm shocked at how great the music in some DS and Advance games are when played through RetroArch. Certain demanding cores like the SNES with the Super FX chip emulation and the Nintendo 64 require just-in-time compilation and dynamic recompile support. Unfortunately, DynaRec and GIT apparently need to work in a different way to comply with security restrictions in applications on the App Store, so cores requiring this for speed improvement are currently out of luck. More powerful Apple devices may be able to run these cores, but on my older iPad, they're not really an option without turning on aggressive frame skipping, and even then the audio quality is poor. However, a lot of Nintendo 64 titles were playable with the default settings, so there may be room to tweak things a little to improve performance. Where this really excels is PlayStation emulation. The games look great on the screen, the frame rates are stable, the controls are tight with little latency, and playing with a DualShock 4 Xbox One controller is really smooth. I know this is just a demo clip, but I played Medieval for so long that my iPad ran out of storage when recording, so I lost the video. Medieval works great, by the way. One thing I didn't use here but wanted to mention is that you can still use screencasting on your Apple device with RetroArch running. So if you have a TV that supports it, you can play from there from your phone or tablet, even using a Bluetooth gamepad. I'd recommend downloading RetroArch for iOS sooner rather than later if you're at all interested in running it on a non-jailbroken Apple device. They have a tendency to allow things on the App Store, then with little notice, remove them. So download it and install it now, even if you don't feel like using it right away. Well, that's all I wanted to go over in this one. Just a quick first look at the official App Store released version of RetroArch for iOS. So you can download it now. And hit the like button to support the channel. That's free too. Thanks for watching.